والله يدعو إلى دار السلام ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. All praise be to Allah alone. We praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. I bear witness that there is no God worthy of worship but Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad, peace be upon him, is his last messenger. Dear viewers everywhere, once again, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and happy and blessed Ramadan. While the entire Muslim Ummah is hosting an honorable guest, which is the month of Ramadan, it is really due upon us to live with the Quran, since Ramadan and the Quran are inseparable from each other. Allah the Almighty said in Surah Al-Baqarah, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل. Because of that, we intended to have this episode and the following three episodes, special editions of Correct Your Citation, where we're going to listen to a beautiful recitation by a great Qari, then afterward we'll shed some light on the meaning and the interpretation of those verses. And in the next segment, inshallah, we'll be happy to listen to the recitation by our guests and try to correct the recitation as well here in the studio together. So please enjoy listening to the recitation after we welcome our dear guest and my brother, Sheikh Mahmoud Sha'ban. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And welcome to the program. Happy Ramadan to you and to your family and to the entire Muslim Ummah. Sheikh Mahmoud is a local imam here in Egypt. I used to drive a long distance in order just to follow his prayer, especially in Fajr prayer. Allah blessed him with a beautiful voice. So I invite you all to listen to his recitation, beginning from Surah Yasin, where we will cover the verses which we studied in the past, along with the new verses, which inshallah, hopefully today, we will shed some light on their meaning. Sheikh Mahmoud, please go ahead.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ياسين والقرآن الحكيم إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم تنزيل العزيز الرحيم لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون لقد حق القول على أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون وجعلنا من بين أيديهم سدا ومن خلفهم سدا فأغشيناهم فهم لا يبصرون وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون إنما تنذر من اتبع الذكر وخشي الرحمن بالغيب فبشره بمغفرة وأجر كريم إنا نحن نحيي الموتى ونكتب ما قدموا وآثارهم وكل شيء أحصيناه في إمام مبين واضرب لهم مثلا أصحاب القرية إذ جاءها المرسلون إذ أرسلنا إليهم اثنين فكذبوهما فعززنا بثالث فقالوا إنا إليكم مرسلون قالوا ما أنتم إلا بشر مثلنا وما أنزل الرحمن من شيء إن أنتم إلا تكذبون قالوا ربنا يعلم إنا إليكم لمرسلون وما علينا إلا البلاغ المبين قالوا إنا تطيرنا بكم لئن لم تنتهوا لنرجمنكم وليمسنكم منا عذاب أليم قالوا طائركم معكم أئن ذكرتم بل أنتم قوم مسرفون وجاء من أقصى المدينة رجل يسعى قال يا قوم اتبعوا المرسلين اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا وهم مهتدون وما لي لا أعبد الذي فطرني وإليه ترجعون أأتخذ من دونه آلهة إن يردني الرحمن بضر لا تغن عني شفاعتهم شيئا لا تغن عني شفاعتهم شيئا ولا ينقذون إني إذا لفي ضلال مبين إني آمنت بربكم فاسمعون قيل ادخل الجنة قال يا ليت قومي يعلمون بما غفر لي ربي وجعلني من المكرمين
ما شاء الله جزاك الله خيرا May Allah bless you. I'm very sure that you brothers and sisters enjoy his recitation as much as they did. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept. Basically, we're going inshallah to resume the meaning of the verses of Surah Yasin beginning with verse number 11. In this verse, Allah the Almighty says, إِنَّمَا تُنْذِرُ مَنِ اتَّبَعَ الذِّكْرَ وَخَشِيَ الرَّحْمَانَ بِالْغَيْبِ فَبَشِّرْهُ بِمَغْفِرَةٍ وَأَجْرٍ كَرِيمٍ Allah the Almighty is addressing His most beloved Prophet, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after He assured him that His opponents are very stubborn. And Allah knew previously that they would not be reminded and they would not accept faith. They would not follow Him. So calm down and take it easy. Whether you warn them or you don't, they will not become believers. Only those who believe in the unseen will benefit out of your reminder. إِنَّمَا تُنْذِرُ مَنِ اتَّبَعَ الذِّكْرَ وَخَشِيَ الرَّحْمَانَ بِالْغَيْبِ Only those who fear the most gracious in the unseen. What does it mean? We notice in the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, the second chapter in the Quran, Allah the Almighty said, this book is guidance for whom? ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ
Those who believe in the unseen.
هُدًا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ Guidance for the righteous ones, for the pious ones, right, Abdullah? Then Allah the Almighty explained their traits. The very first trait of the pious ones is, الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقَنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. So before offering the prayers and before paying the charity, they must believe in order to understand why you're doing so. يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. They believe in the Allah, in Allah the Almighty, in His oneness, even though they haven't seen Him. They believe in hell and heaven, and that they exist, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared a magnificent reward for the good doers in heaven, versus a severe torment for the disbelievers in hell, even though we haven't seen any of that. So the most important quality of the believers and the pious ones is to believe in the unseen. Once we recognize the oneness of Allah, we recognize His exist and His presence, and He is the Lord, He is all worthy of worship. Whatever He informs us with, we must believe in it, even though we could not visualize it. So that's why Allah the Almighty was telling His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, only those who believe in the unseen and fear Allah even though they could not see Him will benefit out of your reminder. For them, give them the glad tidings and the good news. فَبَشِّرْهُ بِمَغْفِرَةٍ وَأَجْرٍ كَرِيمٍ. You know, in order to achieve heaven and to enter paradise on the day of judgment, there is one stage that you have to accomplish first, which is forgiveness. Examine all the verses which talk about heaven, for instance, in Surah Ali Imran, when Allah the Almighty said, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ. سَابِقُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ. Surah Al-Hadid. So their race or haste or come forward, all of you to, if you want to enter heaven, first you have to gain forgiveness. So, inform those who would follow you, would believe in you, would comply with your instructions, with the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah, inform them that Allah the Almighty will forgive them their sins. And furthermore, He has prepared for them ajr kareem, a noble reward, which is heaven and paradise. In several ahadith, if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to encourage the ummah in order to do or not to do anything, he would use this phrase. He would say, "Man kana yu'minu billahi wal yawm al-akhir, let him do so and so." Such as in the sound hadith, "Whosoever believes in Allah and in the last day." The last day, we haven't seen it. And we may die before even witnessing the last day. But eventually, Allah the Almighty will resurrect all of us from the very first to the very last to witness the day of resurrection, then the day of judgment. But we believe in all of that because we have been informed by the sound references in the Quran and the Sunnah. So if the Prophet ﷺ wanted to motivate us to do anything, he would remind us, hey, you believe in Allah, you haven't seen Him. You believe in the last day, even though you haven't seen it, then you gotta do this, or you're gonna stay away from that. مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيُكْرِمْ ضَيْفَهِ. مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيُكْرِمْ جَارَهُ. مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيَقُلْ خَيْرًا أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ. If you truly believe in Allah and in the last day, honor your guest. If you truly believe in Allah in the last day, be good and kind and generous to your neighbor. If you truly believe in Allah and in the last day, which you have not seen, you only heard of it from Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abdullah, then you should either say what's good or be quiet. Zip off your mouth. So an Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam encourages us to achieve good deeds through reminding us with what? With the most important quality of the believers. يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ.
Sheikh, how can we address the unseen to the non-Muslims?
Well, this is a very interesting question, and it would really require a lengthy and quality time in order to explain. First of all, this surah from A to Z would really serve this purpose. In the following verses, and I believe hopefully in the next episode, where Allah the Almighty will be talking about وَآيَةٌ لَهُمُ الْأَرْضُ الْمَيْتَةُ أَحْيَيْنَاهَا, Allah is going to use references, tangible references, to indicate His presence, to indicate and to prove His Lordship. So that would prove that He exists, and He is the Lord, and He is all worthy of worship. Without seeing Him, but through the evidences which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to point out to them. Once, Al-Imam Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, was asked about a reference or a proof that shows that Allah does exist. Show me a sign. You know, humans normally tend to...
materialistic.
They want something that's tangible. They want to have a grip on something to believe in it, right? So Ali ibn Abi Talib, may Allah be pleased with him, said, hey, al-ba'ratu tadullu ala al-ba'ir, wal-atharu yadullu ala al-masir. Al-ba'ra is whenever a camel or a ride defecates the feces of the animals. That the Arab were very familiar with that. They used to trace people through finding out about the feces of the rides, and they would know exactly how long they've been here and how long they've been traveling and which direction have they taken and whether they ate the dates from this city or from that city. They were able to find out through inspecting the rawath, al-ba'h, the feces of the cattle. So he said, if you're able to find out about animals through their feces, and if you're able to find out about whether there was somebody here or not through their footsteps, these are all signs. So then he pointed out to the heavens and to the earth, to the seas, and he said, this heaven without pillars, without hooks lifting up the heavens, this spread out earth, these mountains, the seas, all of that isn't enough to indicate and to prove Allah's presence. So there he's using logic in addition to tangible evidences to indicate and to prove Allah's presence. The surah also would use the same methodology in order to prove that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists, and in order to prove that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only Lord who's worthy of worship. The following verse, Muhammad, is very interesting. The Shaykh recited in verse number 12 what Allah the Almighty said, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى وَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَدَّمُوا وَآثَارَهُمْ وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ أَحْصَيْنَاهُ فِي إِمَامٍ مُبِينٍ. Allah the Almighty says, verily, it is us, we. And by the way, this is a pronoun of a singular who's glorifying and exalting himself. Yeah. So Allah is one. This is a very common objection by the Orientalists and by some of the uneducated people, those who do not know even grammar in English nor in Arabic. They say, how come that you guys say Allah is one, and he keeps saying that, inna nahnu, we. Inna nahnu nazzalna al-dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. Allah the Almighty is saying we. But this is a singular who's glorifying and exalting himself. So Allah the Almighty is saying that it is me who gives life after death, who brings the dead back to life. He's trying to prove what? He's trying to prove that you guys, after you die, we will be able to resurrect you. For what reason? That for counts. Accountability. So the resurrection in order to receive your hisab, your recompense, whether good or bad. And accordingly, we need a reference. We need a record that recorded all our good deeds and bad deeds as well. In order to hold somebody accountable and audit his account, you have to have a record, a very accurate record. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَنَكْتُبُ, and we record in writing, مَا قَدَّمُوا, whatever they have done during their lives. وَآثَرَهُمْ, that is the interesting part. في صحيح الإمام مسلم, we studied before the very famous hadith, Mustafa, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whenever the servant of Allah dies, all his deeds will come to an end. You're dead. It's over. But Allah, out of His generosity and mercy, He provided us with three avenues through which one can still earn reward, can still make good deeds, even though he's dead and he's buried in his grave. He said, for instance, if one have established some continuous charity, one who built a mosque or a Quranic school, so that people are benefiting out of that, printed Qurans, distributed Quran, put a water fountain somewhere, built an orphanage. So the khayr, the goodness, is continuous even after his death, so he still benefits out of that, even though he's dead. The second, a useful knowledge that he taught to people. So as long as this knowledge is spreading, he's been benefiting out of that even though he's dead. And the third is leaving behind a righteous son, or daughter, child, who will make invocation for you and intercede for you before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make dua for you. That is the meaning of آثارهم, their traces, what they have left behind. As a matter of fact, once, and this is a very interesting story, there was a tribe by the name Banu Salama living in Al-Madinah, but they were living in a remote area. And they used to come for every prayer to attend the congregational prayer with the Prophet ﷺ, since the prophetic masjid was in downtown. So it would take them a long distance, walking or riding their mules or donkeys. So there was an area which has become vacant around the masjid. So they decided to wrap up and move. The Prophet ﷺ was informed that Banu Salama were moving. He asked them, why? They said, in order to be near to the masjid. The Prophet ﷺ said, no, I would rather stay there. Banu Salama, diyarukum, tuktab lakum atharukum. Stay where you are. Do not move near to the masjid. Why? He said, because every footstep that you're taking to the masjid provides you with dual benefits. It erases one of your sins and it gives you one deed. It raises you, it ranks one level for each and every footstep. So, the further you are from the masjid, the better for you. So, نَكْتُبُ مَا قَدَّمُوا, what they have done in the past, وَآثَارَهُمْ, and what they have left, even though they're dead, but it is still benefiting others, so it will benefit them as well, such as. There is a very interesting hadith which is collected by Imam Muslim. That means it's a sound hadith. In this hadith, Shindi, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من سن في الإسلام سنة حسنة كان له أجرها وأجر من عمل بها إلى يوم القيامة لا ينقص ذلك من أجورهم شيئا. What does it mean, Abdullah? Whoever prescribes something which is good, so people would act upon it and will follow it. He receives his own reward for doing such thing and instructing people to do it. And furthermore, every single person who follows his footsteps, follows his instruction, and copies him in this regard, he receives his own reward, and the person who prescribed the thing as well gets a similar reward without diminishing the reward of either one of them. Somebody might object and said, I thought you said that it is not permissible for anyone to make a new sunnah. This is obviously true. We agree to that. So what do you mean with the statement man istanna or man sanna? It doesn't mean to invent a new tradition or to make a new sunnah. But let me help you with this. Now we were talking to people who are new to Islam, then we brought to their attention the virtues of praying duha. When you pray Fajr, then you sit and make dhikr until it is sunrise, then 15 minutes later, you offer at least two rak'ahs. These two rak'ahs are known as rak'atay al-duha, right? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the reward of offering complete hajj and umrah. They didn't know about that. But once you told them about it, they started practicing that. So every time they do it, you get a similar reward of theirs, without diminishing or affecting the reward of either one of you. And the opposite is true, Shindi. The Prophet ﷺ said, and whoever invents or prescribes something that is bad or evil, he's a sinner, he committed a sin. And similarly, every person who copies him is committing a sin, and the very first person who invented this bid'ah or introduced that evil deed is also bearing a similar sin of everyone who's committing that sin. It is very serious. That is the meaning of إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَكْتُبُ مَا قَدَّمُوا وَآثَارَهُمْ. And behold, وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ أَحْصَيْنَاهُ فِي إِمَامٍ مُبِينٍ. And all things, good or bad, we have recorded with numbers in a clear record. On the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will spread for every person a record. It will be as long as you can see. Then he will say, my servant, do you object to any of its contents? He can say no. Because it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who recorded your actions. Yet, there is a very interesting story. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that one of those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to have mercy on them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will eliminate their big sins, major ma'asi. Then Allah the Almighty would ask them, do you see that? Have you committed all of that? The bad ones, the minor ones say, yes, 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 they will admit. So Allah the Almighty will say, you know what? I actually conceal your sins for you in the life, and today I forgive you as well. Not only that, I have ordered my angels to convert all the bad deeds which appear in your record into good deeds. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled. Why? Because this person would say, my Lord, but there is something that I wanted to say. What is it? As a matter of fact, there are so many bad deeds are missing. I remember I used to do them. Why? Because he realized now that the bad deeds are being converted into good deeds. We're dealing with the most merciful. I just want to remind you, this mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which consists of 99 portions, 99 parts, as in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah the Almighty divided His mercy into 100 parts. He sent down to our worldly heaven just one part, and He saved with Him 99 portions. He's going to use them to cover the believers with His mercy on the day of judgment. We ask Allah the Almighty in this blessed month to enjoy His mercy in this life and in the hereafter. And in order to enjoy this mercy, we ask Allah to keep us steadfast in this life and to pardon us and to forgive us our sins. This is the month of forgiveness. O Allah, the one who forgives all sins, forgive us our sins. Brothers and sisters, this is all the time we got for this segment. And inshallah, azzajal, we'll take a short break and we'll be back pretty soon. So I kindly request you to stay tuned. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Recite it every day and do read it loud.
One of the highest grades of patience is fasting. Allah said in the divine hadith, إِلَّا الصَّوْمُ فَإِنَّهُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِهِ. Only fasting is sincerely dedicated for me, and I'm the one who will reward for that.
Recite it every day and do read it loud.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. Time flies very fast. And we're due now to listen to the recitation of our guests. And inshallah, azzajal, hopefully we don't need to correct you at all. But if there is anything, we'll be happy to correct it. So we'll begin with Brother Muhammad Shindi from Egypt. Go ahead and recite from the beginning of Surah Yasin.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Yasin. والقرآن الحكيم إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم تنزيل العزيز الرحيم لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم.
We're gonna length the
server. We're going to make it four.
لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون لقد حق القول على أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون وجعلنا من بين أيديهم سدا ومن خلفهم سدا فأغشيناهم فهم لا يبصرون وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون.
جزاك الله خيرا. If you remember الراء, different cases of الراء with regards to التفخيم والترقيق, fattening and thinning. If الراء comes عبد الله ساكنة and it's preceded with the vowel فتحة, then it is definitely
مفخمة,
right? So I want you again to listen to Sheikh Abdullah. He's going, Sheikh Muhammad Mahmoud Sha'ban is going to recite verse number 10, الآية العاشرة من سورة ياسين, and pay close attention to the ra in the first word, أأنذرتهم, versus the ra in the second word, which is تنذرهم. Sheikh Mahmoud, please.
وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون.
ما شاء الله, جزاك الله خيرا. I really like to listen to one more time.
وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون.
Yeah, Allah bless you. So now, even though it's just the same ra, but in the first one it is mufakhama. أَنْذَرْتَهُمْ, and the second one is مُرَقَّقَة, because it is second and it's preceded by كسرة. أَمْ لَمْ تُنْذِرْهُمْ. جيد؟ طيب. مصطفى, please continue.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
I want you to recite verse number 10 again.
وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون.
Just a very little bit of notice here, which is a small notice, which is exactly, Abdullah, بارك الله فيه, Abdullah from France, may Allah bless you, that in order to pronounce the ra fat, what happened is, Mustafa, you pronounced the ذال as ظا. He said أأنذرتهم, rather it is ذال. That is the meaning of to give each letter its حق ومستحق and due characteristics. So you will say أأنذرتهم ذا, not ظا. Again.
وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون. إنما تنذر من اتبع الذكر وخشي الرحمن بالغيب.
The ra of the word الذكر has فتحة, so it's got to be فتحة. الذكر.
إنما تنذر من اتبع الذكر وخشي الرحمن بالغيب. فبشره بمغفرة وأجر كريم. إنما نحن نحيي الموتى. إننا نحن نحيي الموتى.
Basically, it is إننا, but the two noons are joined together and we pronounce it as إننا. So the غنة on the noon, which is مشددة. Two counts, that's number one. Number two, there is a very common mistake that ordinary reciters may not pay any attention to it, which is when you recite the vowel with imala, you're not really pronouncing the vowel properly, whether it's kasra or fatha, but most likely with the kasra. So instead of saying inna, one may say anna, and that doesn't sound like neither kasra nor fatha. So let's listen to verse number 12 again from Sheikh Mahmoud.
إن إنما تنذر من اتبع الذكر وخشي الرحمن بالغيب فبشره بمغفرة وأجر كريم. إنا نحن نحيي الموتى ونكتب ما قدموا وآثارهم وكل شيء أحصيناه في إمام مبين.
ما شاء الله، جزاك الله خيرا. مصطفى، I want to hear this verse again from you, verse number 12.
إنا نحن نحيي الموتى ونكتب ما قدموا وآثارهم.
عبد الله wants to say something, right, عبد الله? What do you want to say? وآثارهم
وكل شيء أحصيناه في إمام مبين.
وكل شيء
أحصيناه في إمام مبين.
Okay.
There's a line here.
Yes. المد المنفصل. We agreed that we're going to prolong المد المنفصل to four counts. وكل شيء أحصيناه في إمام مبين. Continue مصطفى please. Verse number 13.
مثلا أصحاب القرية إذ جاءها المرسلون إذ أرسلنا إليهم اثنين فكذبوهما فعززنا بثالث فقالوا إنا إليكم مرسلون.
We're going to listen to verse number 14, الآية الرابعة عشر, from Sheikh Mahmoud once again, and you will get to recite it after he does. Pay attention to the following facts. بثالثٍ فقالوا. There is إخفاء, right? إخفاء حقيقي. So the غنة is two counts. And as we said, you must pronounce the vowels properly, so we must say فقالوا. Rather, it will be فقالوا. So let's listen to verse number 14 again. Sheikh Mahmoud, please.
إذ أرسلنا إليهم اثنين فكذبوهما فعززنا بثالث فقالوا إنا إليكم مرسلون.
جزاك الله خيرا. مصطفى again.
إذ أرسلنا إليهم اثنين فكذبوهما فعززنا بثالث فقالوا إنا إليكم مرسلون.
Much better except for المد المنفصل. We need to prolong it to before. فقالوا إنا إليكم مرسلون.
فقالوا إنا إليكم مرسلون.
Okay. عبد الله, would you please continue reciting from verse number 15?
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. قالوا ما أنتم إلا بشر مثلنا وما أنزل الرحمن من شيء إن أنتم إلا تكذبون. قالوا ربنا يعلم إنا إليكم لمرسلون وما علينا إلا البلاغ المبين. قالوا إنا تطيرنا بكم لئن لم تنتهوا لنرجمنكم وليمسنكم وليمسنكم منا عذاب أليم.
I would really prefer if you stop at إنا تطيرنا بكم. You take a pause, then you resume beginning with the word the N. Can you do again, please?
From the beginning of the verse?
قالوا. Yep.
قالوا إنا تطيرنا بكم لئن لم تنتهوا لنرجمنكم.
We will stop at the word بكم. And the ra is ساكنة. Do not move it.
Okay.
Okay.
قالوا إنا تطيرنا بكم لئن لم تنتهوا لنرجمنكم وليمسنكم منا عذاب أليم.
ما شاء الله عبد الله, you're doing very well on your own. بارك الله فيك. عبد الله is a revert and he's studying Arabic and Quran and he's doing very well. MashaAllah, may Allah bless you and your family. I'd like to invite you all to listen to verse number 18, Al-Ayah 18, from Sheikh Mahmoud. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi.
قَالُوا إِنَّا تَطَيَّرْنَا بِكُمْ لَإِن لَمْ تَنْتَهُوا لَنَرْجُمَنَّكُمْ وَلَيَمَسَّنَّكُمْ مِنَّا عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ.
بارك الله فيك. Continue, Abdullah.
قَالُوا طَائِرُكُمْ مَعَكُمْ أَإِنْ ذُكِّرْتُمْ بل أنتم قوم مسرفون.
When you stop at the word ذكرتم, make sure that you pronounce and you utter really the letter ميم by collapsing your lips, because you know the articulation point of the ميم أم, right? Yeah. So you say أَإِن ذُكِّرْتُمْ. Okay.
Okay. أَإِن ذُكِّرْتُمْ بل أنتم قوم مسرفون.
And obviously you know that if we were to continue, then there will be a new rule, which is أَإِن ذُكِّرْتُمْ بَلْ أَنتُمْ قَوْمٌ مُسْرِفُونَ. Okay, can you recite it while connecting أَإِن ذُكِّرْتُمْ with the next word?
أَإِن ذُكِّرْتُمْ بَلْ أَنْتُمْ قَوْمٌ مُسْرِفُونَ.
Who remembers the name of this rule? Well, the إقلاب is in the case of a نون الساكنة followed by the باء. أنبئهم فلما أنبأهم. But in the case of الميم الساكنة, it's already ميم. In the case of إقلاب محمد, we convert the نون الساكنة into a ميم ساكنة. But we already have a ميم ساكنة followed by باء.
إخفاء شفوي.
Exactly. That's إخفاء شفوي or شفهي. بارك الله فيك. Okay. Continue.
وجاء من أقصى المدينة رجل يسعى قال يا قوم اتبعوا المرسلين. اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا وهم مهتدون. وما لي لا أعبد الذي فطرني وإليه ترجعون. أأتخذ من دونه آلهة إن يردني الرحمن بضر لا تغن عني شفاعتهم شيئا ولا ينقذون.
عبد الله, let me ask you a question. ما شاء الله, you're doing very well so far. How long have you been studying Quran?
7 years.
7 years, mashallah. So you were not born Muslim.
No.
Basically, yes, you were born Muslim. But for a reason or another, every person, after he's born in a state of the pure nature, his parents would make him either a Jew or a Christian or even an atheist. Then Allah the Almighty have blessed you with
choosing Islam, guided you to Islam. So do you think, is it difficult for those who are born in the folds of Islam, living amongst Muslim families, listening to the Quran since their childhood, is it difficult for them to learn the Quran since they don't know how to recite the Quran yet?
I don't think so.
I mean, I would really confirm your statement, since you're French, you're native French, right?
Yeah.
And it is not your language. Yeah. And mashallah, la quwwata illa billah, you're doing much better than the Arab. So it's a matter, it's not just a compliment, it's a fact that we wanted to inform everybody, whether those who accepted Islam recently, new reverts, or those who are Arab, born with their mother tongue Arabic, but they're reluctant to sit in a halqa and learn tajweed, and their excuse, which is an invalid excuse, of course, is that I don't know how to. I can't recite the Quran. They may recite the newspaper, read the newspaper. But when it comes to reciting the Quran, they're so reluctant. So I thought you are an ideal example. You and others whom we invited to the program that encourage every Muslim to learn how to read the Quran. And it is very easy to achieve. Allah the Almighty said, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكَرٍ. We made this Quran easy to be recited, to be remembered, to be memorized, to be understood. But you just have to make an effort in order to achieve that. You know, there is a sound hadith. In this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, recite the Quran for me. I want to listen to your recitation. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was very reluctant, and he said, O Messenger of Allah, how can I recite the Quran for you and while it was revealed unto you? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, recite it. I like to listen to it from others. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud began reciting from Surah Al-Nisa until he reached a verse which reads, فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جِئْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجِئْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَؤُلَاءِ شَهِيدًا. At this verse, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, حَسْبُكْ. Enough. Stop right there. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud turned to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he noticed that his eyes were overflowing with tears. Listening to the Quran is also an act of worship, and that's why today we enjoyed the company of our honorable guest, Sheikh Mahmoud Sha'ban. Thank you so much. Jazakumullah khairan. And our guests here at the studio, thank you all. And our dear viewers everywhere, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you so much and happy Ramadan. Until next episode, I leave you in peace. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Brothers and sisters, to increase your iman, read the miracle, recite the Quran. Recite it every day and do read it loud. The verses of Quran are all Muslims' pride. This miracle was revealed over a long time span, sent from Allah to an angel, then to a man. That man was Muhammad, the best of creation. We were chosen to be part of his nation. He gave us a message, and that was Islam. So read this miracle, recite the Quran.